today we're going to talk about some of the problems that new users to DMR radios may encounter, and also problems that can be endemic to the cheaper Chinese radios, and what you can do if you do run into some of these problems, and what we do in order to troubleshoot and find the source of some of the problems that people may encounter. So this is started with, we're looking here at the DMR, the MD-390 TYT with the GPS in it. And I recently sold a couple to a client who is a professional guide. And he reported back that after using them for a few weeks, he encountered a number of problems. So in order to try and get to the source of the problems and understand what may have gone wrong, or just to see if they were faulty right off the get-go, I had them sent back to me, and we'll start with that. What we'll do is, here's what the radio looks like when you order one or buy one. You get one in a case with a manual, and the radio and then the accessories are in there. You get a charger, you get a stock antenna, a belt clip, and the manual. And there appears to be, yeah, it is a proprietary programming cable with this model. The standard prolific cable doesn't work, so you get a programming cable as well. So when I got them back, this is what I got back. I got back a Ziploc freezer bag. I recycle these myself, actually, because they're fairly expensive even when you buy them at Costco. And the contents of the order were in this bag, including the IPX antennas, the stock antennas, which I don't believe, don't count on getting those long ones anymore if you do order one of these. It would appear that TYT isn't giving me those anymore, so those don't come with this one. And you can see how easily they bend, although this one was only used for a few weeks. You can see there's in the common place where they often get bent is right on the bottom on the base, and that happens a lot when you're skiing or traveling with them on a duty belt or on your hip belt. If you fall or bend over too hard, you'll bend them at the base. So this is what I got back. So just one comment on this: if you do encounter a similar problem, if you're dealing with a seller and you do have to return products, the seller would probably be much more comfortable if you actually returned them in the original box. The boxes are made for safe shipping. They cushion it. Everything fits in there. And if in the event you've decided that it just wasn't the radio for you, and you're going to get a refund and with a restocking fee, the vendor obviously is going to be able to resell it a lot better if he has it more or less the way they come. So with that little caveat aside, I'm going to read to you the email that's over here and show you a copy in the window. It starts out with a hello, and he mentions he's back now from his work trip. And to put it simply, I am extremely unhappy with my purchase. These radios are unreliable and underperformed next to both my Xianjing and my VX150 radios. And the VX150, as you probably know, is a Yaesu. Been around for quite a while. It was a very rugged, bomb-proof radio. Went through a lot of those. And I don't believe they're made anymore. They're discontinued. I think they've been discontinued for probably a decade. He goes on to say, in fact, I retired the TYTs by the third week and switched over to my old radios. You may be able to come up with reasons why I've had troubles, because your technical understanding of these radios is far beyond mine, which isn't saying much, but thanks anyway. However, I have never had more problems with a radio in my 20-plus career. Some of the issues I experienced, and we're going to address these one by one, I think, in order to find out what's going on with these things. Reduced range brackets compared to my old radios, poorly designed antennas, one damaged within a few days of normal use. And I thought he would be referring to the stock antenna, which is this or that. But in fact, it turns out it's the IPX6 line of antennas. And it's this one here, obviously, that's got quite a severe kink in the bottom. All the CPC300 tubing is separated where it was adhesive before, and it's been somehow cut with a knife around the base. I'm not sure why. I believe it was probably in order to unscrew this base, and then you can fit these Smiley stock antennas onto, this is an SMA male base, and you can fit this onto a radio like a Wushan that takes an SMA female instead. So perhaps that's what went on. If we look back, which were exactly. The Shanjing, which is this radio here, that's a Shanjing, it actually does have an SMA female base on it, so I would assume that perhaps the client had wished to get this better antenna onto the Shanjing and had to cut that, and maybe in the process something else happened, because these antennas, the technology behind these, I did not develop them. I'd like to take credit, but everything that's in this antenna was developed for the Navy SEALs, and they use the same CPC300 tubing. It's a dual wall polyolefin tubing, very stringent applications that it's made to, and this is what the Navy SEALs use. So here it says that the poorly designed antenna is one damaged within a few days of normal use. I guess if you're a Navy SEAL, normal use would be different than say a guide, and perhaps guides have a different standard that they require for the antennas than the Navy SEALs, but so far all the other guides seem to have been doing fine. So this is one that's a bit of a mystery, and it'll probably remain a mystery as to what actually happened to this antenna. Normal use, I would suggest perhaps not. Carrying on. Receiving transmissions are in broken chunks only, perfectly received by other radios, brackets. No battery indication, battery was low, then died. Battery died within a 6-hour period of being turned on numerous times. No ability to program family radio frequencies, which otherwise known as FRS, and granted, brackets, I think that this problem can be rectified in the setup. And lastly, SMS messages sent and received, spotty at best, entire messages dropped. So he says in closing, I've come to the conclusion that these radios aren't reliable enough for me to work with them in a professional setting. I would like to return them to you and receive a full refund. Having said that, I still need a radios that would be willing to work, and I'd be willing to work with you on finding a solution that works for me if you would still like the business. Thanks, John. Feel free to discuss. Okay, so then begins the process of trying to figure out and address all these concerns. We've already talked about the antenna concern, and I can't go much further with that other than to say and point out this is the rest of the antenna order, and this is how they are shipped. The base is, unless you're going to use a rat tail with it, if you don't order a rat tail with the antennas, then of course the base is integral. It's all one piece to keep the waterproofing and the IPX rating up there. I use a special tool if I build the antenna with a heat shrink this section, then that section, and then mate them together, so I don't have to use brute force in order to try and break the tubing and then get that base taken off. And in fact, I've just found another kind of cool tool that I've ordered, and that will help me with breaking this if it's after the fact for clients that may decide later they want to use a rat tail or change the bases. Just one last quick suggestion about this antenna, if I may. If you do need to trim it in order to be able to remove the base to put a different gender base on a Smiley antenna, instead of popping your knife like this, your pocket knife out of your pocket, and you know, kind of butchering away at the antenna. Maybe the best bet is at least go off and maybe find an X-Acto knife, and then you can circumcise around the point that's right above the top of the reflector tape. However, if you do know anybody that has a tool like this, this is what's known as a round cable slitting and ringing tool, and that makes the best cut, and it won't damage your antenna. So if you know anybody that works in the cable industry doing TV installs or cutting coax or something, if they have access to a tool like that, that's what you should be using to cut the base of your antenna if possible. Now, this brings us on to what we do next, and you're probably hearing a beeping that just started up while I was talking here in the last 30 seconds. That beep is the alarm that tells me that the battery discharge test has just concluded. It's been running for about, since, I don't know, maybe just after lunch, and now it's about 10:30 in the evening. And what it's telling me is it's concluded the test, and it's been testing one of these battery packs from these radios, because the next thing we have to address is battery died within a 6-hour period being turned on. These battery packs, like all Chinese battery packs, are overrated for sure. And so the manufacturer is saying that this battery pack is 2200 milliamps. And the only battery pack or radio that I've found that comes close to what the manufacturer claims is actually one of the cheapest radios on the market, the Xianjing. And this thing almost got up to the 1600 milliamp rating it was rated for. So when I did the test, and you can actually see the tests on this battery pack on a complete video in our channel all by itself, but I need to check now every battery that went out with this order to confirm that there aren't any faulty batteries in the batch. And so I'm going to take you over here to the test. And sorry, hope you don't get seasick easily. And you can see here that there's the battery and there's the test running. I'll refocus this for you. And I know with the lights on in the office here, it can be kind of hard to read that LED display. I might have to read it for you and you'll have to take my word. But what it's showing here is 18.89. So I'm consistently getting about 1900 milliamps from all these battery packs. So under the state of charge rules, I think we're right around that 80% SOC that we would like to see for all these packs. And we seem to be just getting that. What we find now is now the battery's no longer under load. It's recovered again to 7.49, we'll call it 7.5 volts. And by the time it went out, it had achieved about 14 watt hours. So let's say you would get, that would be 14 hours if you were drawing 1 watt. And if you were constantly transmitting at 5 watts, which is the high power setting on the radio, and you did nothing but transmit, and you could do that without overheating the radio, which isn't likely, you would get 5 into 14, and that's how many hours of transmit time you'd get. So you'd get like 3 hours of transmit or a little less. However, nobody transmits for a full hour. In fact, the average industry standard that is based upon is 5590. And so 5590 means 5 minutes of transmit, 5 minutes of receive, and 95% transmit, 5% receive, 90% standby. And I'll throw those figures, I'll have to crunch them on there. But what we're going to find is probably we're going to get quite a few hours out of that, much more than 6 for sure. And so all we can say now at this point is, and I've done the other battery packs, they're all same spec. They're all just about 1900 milliamps. So then we're going to have to look for another reason why those battery packs or the radios would be dying in 6 hours. And that means could be due to faulty chargers, not bringing the battery. My comments about maybe some of the advantages of returning or repacking your goods into the original box for a return might be a good way to double check what you're actually doing. I just happened to notice as I came to pack this stuff up that I picked up the charger and it rattled, and I thought, oh my goodness, did we send a charger? Then I looked at the charger and it looked pretty, a lot of dirt in it for being a new charger, kind of scratched up. And then it dawned on me, these radios are TYT, and that's what you're supposed to be getting. And in fact, what I've got here is the charging charger. So I think this is more inconvenient to the client than myself at this point, because what it means is he's probably not able to charge one of his two remaining radios. So we will have to try and rectify that problem and get this charger back to him as soon as possible. But heads up, when you're sending stuff back, maybe just double check. So now at this point, I think we're going to take everybody off to the world of Google Earth Pro and also up Tunnel Mountain, and we will see what happened on our tests out in the field where we were actually testing the distances, and then have a look at what resulted from the GPS tests on Google Earth Pro. So I'm presently on the top of Tunnel now, and it's hard to see where She Must Be Obeyed is, but she's gone off for a ski with her team of co-workers, and it was an opportunity for me to try a radio test from behind two landforms. One will be the back of Sulphur. You can see the there's the peak where the gondola is. We're looking right up at the gondola there now, Sansom Peak, and then you follow the ridge down, and they are behind the ridge.
So I'm in place on the front side of Tunnel. She Must Be Obeyed is currently down behind the ridge on Sulphur, and I'm going to try first of all to contact on the digital channel. And the advantage of using a digital channel is when I bring up the channel, if I can see on the little globe icon that if there's no red X behind it, I think that means that that person is acquiring or not acquiring satellites. And she's just using the stock antenna. I had to change over to this tuned antenna when I was behind the backside of Tunnel in order to get her. So it illustrates to me the importance of having the proper tuned antenna on. Now we're going to see if we can raise her here, but with that red icon on the globe, I'm thinking that I won't be able to query her GPS. Sharon, She Must Be Obeyed from Obsequious One, how do you copy?
555.
Okay, can you give me a 10 count, please?
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10.
Okay, roger on that. Got all of 1 to 10. I'm going to repeat same. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and how on that?
10 by 5. I mean 5 by 5.
No, it's only 10 by 5 when I get to be over 70. How's your team doing?
Team is getting ready to head out again.
Are you guys going to be heading westbound, or are you going back east when you leave that location? I need to run a test from the backside of tunnels, so if you give me a few minutes, I'll pop back there and see if I can still get you. All right, we just brought up Sharon's GPS info, and because my phone has gone dead, it's so cold, its battery always gives up. I tend to lose that phone battery when it's around, right now it's about minus 18 to minus 20. Centigrade. So I just lost the GPS info, so I'm going to bring it up again. And how you do that is you go into contacts, or sorry, you go to utilities, and then you go up to GPS Baidu info, hit confirm, and what we've got for her is north 51 10.6456 and west 11533 .2380. So that's the screen that times out after.
Just getting ready now.
Okay, I just received your GPS coordinates, and I'm going to try sending you a text message now as part of the test here. And were you able to copy all that?
Yep, I'm just moving, so.
North 51 09.9290, west 11536.9404. Again, before the screen time, the screen's timed out already. So I'll have to play this back to get that and plot it on Google Earth. And then I'll be able to show my location and her location on Google Earth. Now I'm going to run over to the backside behind us. Here's a quick overview of our locations, courtesy of Google Earth. We'll start, if you can see the cursor here, on my location on the top of Tunnel Mountain. And we'll just zoom out a little bit here. Actually, we will... And now you can see the town of Banff coming up on the left. And as we fly over to Sharon's location, follow the red line, and that's where she was, the Bow River there, and the shoulder, just in behind the shoulder of where Sulphur comes down. And the total distance of that is 4.5 kilometers. Okay, now I've made it down to the backside. I'm down behind a brow of land here on Tunnel, and we're going to try connecting with Shiomas B08, who's down behind the ridge on Sulphur. Sharon, how do you copy now? How do you copy? Sharon, how do you copy? How do you copy?
Now I have put on the damaged antenna that we got back, and you'll recall this is our mil-spec antenna that this technology, it's the same as used by the Navy SEALs. They order this, it's a CPC 300 tubing, and the way it's constructed and put on their dual wall, the velocity factors are factored into the design, and they're all tested, and they've been working very well. So I've put this one on, and we're gonna hit the push to talk. And it looks like that antenna is still working quite acceptably, even though it appears to be broken. A standing wave of 2, as opposed to the previous standing wave of over 13. So we see here that indeed this antenna has been subjected to some pretty severe trauma, but it's still stepping up to the plate and doing what's expected of it. So now we're still on the same frequency, and I thought it might be interesting and instructive. I have put a new antenna, which is center tuned to the same wavelength on there, which is the, you can just see it printed on there, the 165 to 175 range. And we're gonna have a look at that and see how it compares to the damaged one, 1.6. So, very similar. And now a look at the damaged antenna. You can see the kink there and 2.2. So we do have that damage has increased the standing wave over a brand new one, due probably to that kink. But it still has continuity, and it still seems to be radiating at a fairly acceptable level. That's a standing wave that is acceptable. Just out of curiosity, now I'm going to put on a 170 to 179, so it's center tuned to 175, and just see how that's doing with this range. Now we're back to the stock antenna, and we're going to move forward with reflected and forward power capabilities of these various antennas. Starting now with reflected power, and we're 5.3. We'll move over now to forward power, 7.2. Now we're on the 170 to 179. Standing wave of 4.9. So as you can see, we're right on the edge of what that one's capable of, because it's center tuned for 175 and we're on 170. But compared to the stock antenna, you can clearly see which antenna you would rather be using. Next, we're going to move over to the damaged antenna. And we will start with forward power, 6.5. And I'm just going to write that down. And now for reflected, 1.5. And last, we're going to go with a brand new antenna and the same tests, and we will start with reflected, 0.5. And now we're going to move on to forward power, 7.1. So what we can see here is what we're looking for is the most amount of forward power and the least amount of reflected power. And that means then that the larger the number that results from subtracting the reflected from the power is better. And we get a number of 6.6 on the new antenna. And we get a number of 5 on the damaged antenna, and we get a number of 2.1 on a stock antenna. So clearly, it would be better not to use a damaged antenna. And you can clearly see the difference that using a proper tuned antenna as you move away from 155 area on these radios. When I switched the radios on, there's one other thing came to my attention that would be worth noting. It can create a lot of problems if you're trying to transmit, and if you'll notice this little icon here, it's a speaker with an X after it on the right hand side. And then what that means is your tone and your tone codes are now disabled and shut off. So that would lead to you having problems not only with accessing repeaters, most of which require tone codes, and if those are in your frequency list, now they're disabled. And if you're trying to talk to other people's radios and they also have tone decode stipulated on their radios, you will not be able to talk to them. They won't hear you. So if you do notice that and you're not sure how it got there, what we'll do is quickly run through how you get out of that. And that will be, you'll activate the menu. I'm sideways here, so you have to excuse me if I have a bit of trouble. Go to utilities, and I believe it's radio settings, and then go down to tones and alerts, and then all tones, and then scroll up to turn on, and then hit the green button. You'll see here how it was turned off. Not sure how it got turned off, probably by accident somehow, and then it wasn't noticed. So all tones on, and then now you go back out, and now you'll see the speaker has disappeared. So if you suffer from that problem, then that's how you'll rectify that one. How do you know what frequency you're on? That's a good question. So you say, great, I've got this channel called Sharon, and I've got a green antenna that says 160 to 170. How do I know if that's going to be the correct antenna to use for this alphanumeric channel that doesn't show me the frequency? So that's when you have to go into the menu system, and you will go to scroll down to utilities, and then you will go down to radio, or you don't, you just take radio settings, and then we will go to, sorry, it's hard for me to see because I'm sideways so that this can be seen in the and that's what I'm looking for, mode. And then you've got channel mode or MR mode. So now we're going to go down to MR mode and hit confirm, and then we're going to back out, and there we go. Now we see Sharon was actually 163.1, and this antenna covers 160 to 170, so it's pretty close to the center tune point, so that's the antenna that we're going to prefer to use. And then you can go and reverse that whole procedure to get your alphanumeric name back again as the display on your channel.
If you would like to have an audible battery indicator assignment to one of your side buttons, you will indicate it here. Let's say, for example, you wanted the top button for a short press and you didn't want both of them. Then you could take this bottom one and pick any of these options for the bottom button. Then for the top one, the short press, which is just a quick hit on that button, will bring up some beeps, and roughly what you end up getting is if you get three beeps, your voltage is still quite high. Probably around above 7.9 volts, somewhere in the range of 8.4 to 8 volts. You get two, you're going to be between 7.6 to 7.9, and one, you're getting down to your lower third, probably around 7.4 to 7.5 range, or below 7.5. So if you need that, you've got that. That's about the best you're going to do. So I would prefer to have seen a voltage readout like they have in the Anytone, but unfortunately they have not put that into this radio, and that would be one of the cons that you would hope that they could rectify maybe in future versions of the firmware. What you'll find when new users come to a digital radio from an analog radio is trying to get in touch with the plethora of new features that you encounter. This is a look at the programming software, and there are already a couple of tutorials on the internet or on YouTube showing how to use this software, proving that the adage that opinions are like YouTube reviews, everybody has one. So you run through, you can just get an idea here when you start looking at all the parameters that you've got to figure out how to set those, and the manual is not much help. So you're pretty much on your own, and Chirp is working on supporting this. I don't think they're quite there yet, and when they are, that'll be one option. The best is going to be when RT Systems comes along and supports this software. Here, for example, is where you can enter up to 1,000 channels and put them into zones. So those are all the parts that you need to come to terms with. And it does involve sitting down and spending time learning what's going on. If you can't transmit, is it because the radio is junk, or have you somehow disabled tone codes? If you're not getting very far, is it because the radio is junk, or you've still got the stock antenna on and you're trying to transmit on somewhere around 165 or 170 and you've got a standing wave of 13 and you've got reflected power that is within a half a watt of what your forward power, so it's left you a half a watt of forward power available to go out as a signal, and all the rest is going back into your radio. That means that there is a curve to get over and start learning how to use the radio as a tool properly, like any tool given to any tradesman. So if you're a professional that's working in the field and you rely on a radio to help yourself or to help others, it is incumbent upon you, just like your 80-hour EMR course, your EMT course, becoming a paramedic, becoming a professional guide, you do have to spend time learning how to use the radio effectively, and that does require a fair bit of effort. So you can see here, we're just going to exit this, and you can see there's a number of sites. They have the radio on Amazon, there's customer reviews, and again, some of these customer reviews can lead you to the conclusion that they also didn't understand the concept about what they were getting into. There seems to be a lot of misconceptions about the need for a code plug, for example, which is unnecessary. So again, here we have some YouTube reviews. So there you go. And here is a another programming tutorial. Here's Chirp Site, and they're talking about supporting the 390. And lastly, Google is your best friend. So that's it. The radio may not be the best fit, but if you do want to find someone when they've gone into a tree well, or they've gone missing and they're carrying another one of the same radio, it enables you to do that. If you need to send private messages to other people in your team, it enables that. If you need to have private conversations with people in your team, it enables that as well. If you want to have greater battery life due to all the energy savings that are provided by digital communication rather than analog, just like in the cell phone world when we went from analog, then again, the DMR radio is the obvious choice. If you prefer a bigger display with more alphanumeric characters at scroll, so it's more meaningful as to what the channel might mean, then you'll consider this. If you like a color display, you'll consider it. If you don't like a steep learning curve and you don't like having to spend time trying to get to terms with all these issues, then it's not the radio for you. Sorry, this has been a very long video. That's why I've put the contents in the description at the front. Hopefully, if you're still here, you'll be one of a very small select few people that have gone through this whole thing, that is for sure. Thanks for watching, and I don't know, I don't think you need to bother subscribing. There aren't a lot of things in this channel that are much value other than specific interest items that may catch the odd little niche of people, but it's fun, and thanks again.